So, welcome everybody to another session of Logics in Quarantena. On behalf of the Brazilian Logic Society and the Logic Interest Group of the Brazilian Computer Society, I'd like to thank you very much, David Trotta, who kindly accepted our invitation to give this talk. David, thank you very much.
Thank you. I want to thank all the organizers, and I'm very sorry for this technical problem. I hope that it will be clear. I want also to thank my co-authors, because in this talk I will present a joint work with Valeria De Paiva and Matteo Spadetto. So thank you, Valeria. I want also to thank Matteo, which cannot follow this seminar. But yes, in this talk I will present results which are part of a joint work with Valeria and Matteo. And the main goal is to introduce the notion of the Gödel vibration and to show how this notion is connected with the dialectic interpretation. In particular, I will try to explain how the notion of Gödel vibration embodies in some sense the main logical principle, in particular the main choice principle, involved in the dialectic and translation. And we will see all the detail later. Before starting with the notion and all the technical part, I would like just to spend a few minutes and recalling and make a very quick, very short summary about the history of the dialectic interpretation, and in particular about its developments from a categorical perspective. So I think that Bruno, you can change the slide. Thank you. So the first work that I need to mention is clearly the original work of Gödel. And Gödel, in 1958, introduced the dialectica interpretation in order to prove the relative consistency of the intuitionistic arithmetic. I don't want to give all the detail, but I want just to recall the main concepts and the main ideas which are involved in this translation, because I think that it is fundamental to understand what are our motivations and what are the intuition behind the notion of the Gödel vibration. So, the dialectic interpretation of Gödel is essentially an interpretation of the intuitionistic arithmetic in a quantifier-free theory of functionals of finite type called System T by Gödel. And well, the idea is to translate every formula A of the arithmetics to a formula which has this very particular form. There exists X such that for all Y, A of D, where A of D is a quantifier-free formula. Propositions which this particular form will come back a lot of time in this talk. So, the dialectic interpretation essentially translates a formula into a formula with this particular form. And the application, as I said, the main application is to prove the relative consistency of the arithmetic, which means if the arithmetic proves A, then the system T proves a formula AD, where the second component y is a string of variables for functional of finite type, and the first element is a suite T, is a suitable sequence of term not containing the variables y. And the goal is to be as constructive as possible in this translation, and while being able to interpret all the arithmetic. So these are the main ideas and the main concepts involved in this translation. At the bottom of the slide, you can find some references. In this slide, there is the reference to the original work of Gödel. And well, this dialectica interpretation has been, you can find a lot of work in which this dialectica interpretation has been generalized or applied in several settings. And I think that now you can change the slide. And well, the main generalization of this notion that I'm going to to use today is essentially the presentation of the dialectic interpretation from a categorical perspective. In particular, in the PhD thesis of Valeria, we can find the first categorical presentation of this interpretation. And this is the so-called dialectica category, which is essentially a category which represents the dialectica interpretation in category theory. And well, a dialectica category is a category constructed in this way. We start with a given category C with finite limits, and one can build a new category denoted in this way, whose objects are essentially triples, whose first and second components are objects of the base category C. And the last component is a subobject of the object X times U in the category C. An object of this kind is thought of as the formula: there exists X such that for all U, alpha X and U. So the first object of the triple, the X, is essentially an object which represents those variables of the formula alpha, which are bounded by an existential quantifier, while the second element U is an object which represents those variables of the formula alpha, which are bounded by the universal quantifier. And well, an arrow from an object of this kind to another object of the form that exists Y, such that for all V and B, beta of Y and B, is essentially a pair of terms subject to this condition, which is a condition which is motivated by the way the dialectic interpretation acts on the implicational formulae. Again, I don't want to give all the detail, but I want just to recall the main idea and the main concepts. We will see all the detail of the dialectica construction in the second part of this talk, when I will recall the dialectica construction in the setting of vibrations. So this is the first notion of dialectica category introduced in the PhD thesis of Valeria De Paiva under the supervision of Martin Nyland. You can change the slide. And as I said, you can find a lot of generalizations and applications of this notion. But the version that I will consider today is the dialectica construction in the general setting of vibrations. So given a vibration, one can construct the so-called dialectica vibration. And under the assumption that the base category of the vibration P is Cartesian closed, then this construction is monadic. So this is a result due to Hofstra. And this essentially means that the operation, that the construction that given a vibration P provides a new vibration called the dialectica vibration, is a monad, is a pseudo-monad in particular. And this is the starting point of our work, because the main goal of this talk is to answer to two questions. You can change the slide. Well, we have seen that the dialectica construction is a monad. And a natural question is, well, what are the key properties that a given vibration should satisfy, has to satisfy, in order to be an instance of the dialectica construction? In other words, given a vibration P, when is there another vibration P prime, such that when we apply the dialectica construction to P prime, we get P? And in this talk, I want to answer to this question. And I want also to show when such a vibration P prime exists, I want to show how this is done. And the answer to this question will be the following. A fibration is an instance of the dialectical construction if and only if it is a Gödel fibration. So this is the reason why we introduced the notion of the Gödel fibration, because we want to provide an intrinsic characterization of those dialectical fibration, of those vibrations which are instances of the dialectical construction. So this is our main goal. We want to understand what are the key properties that a vibration should satisfy in order to be a dialectical vibration. So this is the plan of this talk. And now I want to introduce and to recall some notions about the theory of vibration in order to fix the notation and to recall the main notions. And for all the detail you can about the theory of vibrations, you can there is the book of Jacobs, Categorical Logic and Type Theory. Now I want to quickly recall the definition of vibration and its meaning from a logical point of view. Well, a vibration, if you have any question, please, you can stop me and I will be happy to try to answer. Well, a vibration is essentially a functor from P, from a category to another category B. The category E is called the total category, while the category B is called the base category of the vibration, such that for every object of the total category E and for every arrow U, there exists a Cartesian arrow F over U. You can find the first definition is the definition of Cartesian arrow. It is a technical definition, but I want just to give you an intuition of what is the logical meaning behind the notion of vibration. Well, the idea is that if we consider a vibration, the base category B represents essentially the category of contexts. So a category whose objects are contexts, and whose arrows are lists of terms. So this is the intuition behind the base category. And the element of a fiber are thought of as propositions on a given context. So if we consider an object of the base category, so if we consider a context, an element which of the fiber over this context, so which is an element of the total category E, is essentially a formula in this given context. And an arrow of the base induces a functor between the fibers, which acts as, it is essentially a reindexing functor. So it acts by applying a substitution to a given formula. So this is the logical intuition behind the notion of vibration. In the next definitions, you can change the slide. Thank you. So now I want to recall the definition of vibration with simple coproducts. The idea is that a vibration with a simple coproduct is a vibration which has enough structure to interpret the existential quantifier. This is the idea. So we say that a vibration over a base category B with finite products has simple coproducts when the weakening functors have left adjoints satisfying the Beck-Chevalier condition. So this is the standard notation used, for example, by Jacobs or by Hofstra, for example. And this means exactly that this vibration is able to interpret the existential quantifier. So a left adjoint along the projection represent an existential quantifier in the vibration. And the Beck-Chevalier condition, well, means essentially that the existential quantifier commutes in the right way with the substitution. This is the meaning. And dually, we say that a vibration has a simple product when the weakening functor have right adjoints denoted in the with the other symbol satisfying again the Beck-Chevalley condition. So this means that a fibration with simple products is a fibration which can interpret the universal quantifier. So this is the standard way of present universal and the existential quantifier in categorical logic due to Lovier, essentially, because Lovier was the first one who understood that the existential quantifier has to be represented as a left adjoint in category theory, and the universal quantifier has to be represented as a right adjoint along the weakening functors. So this is the standard way of represent the quantifier in the language of fibrations. You can change the slide. Now in the next definition, I want to formalize a very standard notion of logic, which is the notion of an element which is free from the existential quantifier. If you open a book of logic, you can find a lot of times this we consider an element which is free from the existential quantifier, for example. Now the goal of the following definition is to formalize this notion in category theory, in particular in the language of the fibrations. Please, can you come back, because I want to. Okay, thank you. And before seeing the formal definition, which is quite complicated and technical, I want to give you an idea of what is the universal property that an element of a given fibration should satisfy in order to be an element which is free from the existential quantifier. So an element alpha of a given fibration is said to be free from the existential quantifier if it satisfies the following universal property. If there is a proof of a statement of the form there exists is such that beta of phi assuming alpha, then there exists a witness T, which is a term, which depends on the proof pi, together with a proof of beta of T, assuming alpha. And moreover, we require that this holds for every reindexing of alpha. Because, for example, in logic, if we consider if an element is free from the existential quantifier, if we apply a substitution on this proposition, we get a new formula which is free from the existential quantifier. So this is the reason why we want to require that this universal property has to hold for every reindexing of the formula. And the formal definition is the following in the next slide. So let us consider a fibration with the simple coproducts. An object alpha of the fiber on a given object of the base category E is said to be free from the existential quantifier if it enjoys the following universal property. For every pair of arrow, where the first component is a projection and the second arrow F is just an arrow of the base category, and for every vertical arrow, so for every arrow in the fiber from the reindexing of alpha into the simple coproduct along the projection on beta, where beta is an object of the fiber on A times B, there exists a unique arrow G in the base category and a unique vertical arrow in the fiber denoted in this way from the reindexing of along F of alpha into this reindexing along G of beta, such that when we consider the composition of this new arrow and the canonical arrow obtained by applying the rendering along the identity and the G on the unit of the adjunction, we get our original arrow age. If you change the slide, I want to show a diagram to explain, to give you a more, I hope that this diagram will help to understand the definition, because it is quite technical. So let us consider an arrow age from a formula alpha of f into another formula, which is there exists x such that bit of x. You can change the slide. Well, given an arrow of this form, alpha is said to be free from the existential quantifier if there exists a term t, which is a witness, together with an arrow, you can press the, thank you, together with an arrow, denoted in this way, it is the red arrow, such that when we compose this new arrow, the red one, with, with the canonical arrow, we get our original arrow age. Notice that if we consider a proposition beta and we have a witness t, we can always construct a canonical arrow from beta of t to the formula that exists beta of that exists x such that beta of x, because if we assume that beta of t is true, then we can prove that there exists an x such that bit of x. So the canonical arrow always exists. And what we require is that there exists a unique t and a unique arrow denoted by overline age from alpha of f to bit of t. If this property holds for every rendering of alpha, then we say that alpha is free from the existential quantifier. Now we can see the next definition. And well, now we want to say that every element of a fibration is isomorphic, every formula is isomorphic to a formula of the kind that exists x, and then a formula which is free from the existential quantifier. We want to formalize this this concept in the language of fibrations. So we say that a fibration with simple coproduct has enough elements which are free from the existential quantifier if for every element of, if for every object of the base category and for every element alpha of a given fiber, there exists an object A of the base category and an element beta which is free from the existential quantifier, such that alpha is isomorphic to the simple coproduct along the projection on E of beta. So this means essentially that every formula, every element of the given fiber, so every formula can be is isomorphic to a formula which has an existential quantifier, and then it is followed by a formula which is free from the existential quantifier. This is the meaning of this definition from a logical point of view. You can change the slide. Now we have seen this notion for the fibration with the simple coproducts. Now we can dualize all the previous notions for the case of a fibration with the simple products. So we need to change all the directions of the arrows, and we can express the same notions for fibration which has simple products. So in this case, an object alpha of a given fiber is said to be free from the universal quantifier or free from the simple product if it enjoys the dual property of the previous one. So if for every arrow F and for any projection on of the in the base category, and for every vertical arrow from the simple product of beta into the reindexing along F of alpha, we get that there exists a unique arrow G from A to B and a unique vertical arrow. Notice that now we are changing the direction on this unique vertical arrow, such that age is equal to the composition of the reindexing along the identity and G of the co-unit of the adjunction, followed by the unique arrow A, followed by the unique... do you have any question?
Yes, I do have a question, but I mean, I think I understand that you can always dualize everything that you did before, but I think what I wanted to ask is, you know, when you're doing this, I think when you're doing this characterization of the existential free formulas, you know, what we are trying to say is simply that that there are formulas in first order logic that have no existential quantifiers, right? That's the notion that we are trying to grab.
Yeah, sure.
But, you know, if Bruno, if you can come back one more slide, that's the right one, right? But then, you know, what I wanted to understand better, David, is what is the pi i's that we are quantifying over with the, and I understand that we are trying to kind of come up with, I mean, it's a traditional thing in logic to do elimination of quantifications, of quantifiers, yeah. Right? You know, that's one of the big tools that we have in logic is to say, let's get rid of quantifiers. And in a way, the existential quantifier is easier to get rid of because you only have to provide one object instead of an infinite set of ones. But what I don't still understand very well is this pi capital I under the existential beta. What are we quantifying? What are these guys? Logically speaking, instead of instead of categorically speaking, please.
Okay, I'm trying. This means that if we have a formula alpha, which was free of three variable R in a given context E,
yes.
This is probable equivalent to another formula which has this form, which is that there exists, and then all the variable of the context A, and then a formula which has two kind of variables, the variables of the context A and the variables of the context E. And this formula beta is free from the existential quantifier. So the right formula, the simple coproduct of along the projection on E of beta, is a formula whose free variables are exactly the free variables of alpha. This is the, I don't know if this was the question.
That is the question. Yeah, I think the question. I'll keep my other question for later on. Carry on. I mean, that's fine. Just you can say simply to Bruno next. I think it works fine too. You know, please, Bruno, next.
Okay. So okay. Now we can say this is so. This is the. This is the definition of elements which are free from the universal quantifier. So this is just the dual notion of the previous one. And similarly, we can see the notion of vibration, which has enough element free from the universal quantifier in the following slide. Okay. So we say that a vibration with the simple product has enough elements which are free from the universal quantifier if, again, every element of a given fiber, alpha, for every element of a given fiber, there exists an object of the base category and an element beta, which is free from the existential quantifier, such that alpha is isomorphic to the simple product of beta. So this is the dual notion for the universal quantifier of the previous one. Now, we can change the slide. Now, we have seen a categorical presentation of elements which are free from the existential quantifier and of elements which are free from the universal quantifier. Now I'm going to introduce the notion of Skolem fibration, which is essentially a fibration satisfying a very strong choice principle. And we define this Skolem fibration using the previous notion of elements which are free from the existential quantifier and elements which are free from the universal quantifier. So a fibration is called a Skolem fibration if the base category is Cartesian closed, if the fibration P has simple products and simple coproduct. So P is a fibration in which we can interpret both the existential and the universal quantifier. The fibration P has enough elements which are free from the existential quantifier. And the last condition, which is that the object which are free from the existential quantifier are stable under simple coproduct, under a simple product. Well, this condition means essentially that if we have an element which is free from the existential quantifier, and we apply a universal quantifier on this element, we get again an element which is free from the existential quantifier. This is exactly what happened in logic. If we have an element which is free from the existential quantifier, if we apply a quantification, the universal quantifier, we get again an element which is free from the existential quantifier. So the last point is exactly a categorification of this idea. So this means that every element which is free from the simple coproduct is essentially stable under the simple product. So if an element is a quantifier free, is a simple coproduct quantifier free object, then when we apply the simple product of alpha is again an element which is free from the existential quantifier for every projection. So this is the notion of Skolem fibration. And in the next slide, I want to explain what is the reason why this is called a Skolem fibration. Well, every Skolem fibration validates this principle, which is a sort of principle of choice. This is called by Troelstra and Hofstra the principle of Skolemization. And this means essentially that for every x, such that there exists y, such that alpha, well, this formula is isomorphic to the formula. There exists f, which is f is a function, is an element of higher order in some sense, such that, and this is the reason why this is a sort of principle of choice, because we have that there exists a function f such that for all x, the formula alpha on e x and f applied to x holds. So this is the so-called principle of Skolemization, and every Skolem fibration validates this principle. This is one of the principles which are involved in the dialectic and translation. So this is the reason why we define this particular notion of Skolem fibration. And this is the base to define the notion of the Gödel fibration, which is in the following slide. So a Skolem fibration is called a Gödel fibration if the sub-fibration whose elements are those elements of P which are free from the simple coproduct. So those elements of P which are free from the existential quantifier. If Skolem fibration is called a Godel fibration, if this subfibration has enough element free from the universal quantifier. So notice that we are asking the property of being free from the universal quantifier, not in the Skolem fibration P, but in the subfibration of those elements which are free from the existential quantifier. This is the notion of the Godel fibration. So it is a very particular kind of Skolem fibration, and a very nice property of this Godel fibration is the following in the next slide. We have that in a Godel fibration, every element, every formula of a given fiber, so for every element alpha of a given fiber on E, there exists an element beta such that alpha is isomorphic to there exists x such that for all y, beta, where beta is an element which is free from the existential quantifier in the total fibration, and which is free from the universal quantifier, not in the fibration P, but in the subfibration, whose elements are those which are free from the existential quantifier, this bar P. And notice that this essentially means that every formula of a Godel fibration can be represented in this way. And I want to recall that in the first slide, this is essentially the action of the dialectic interpretation. The dialectic interpretation introduced by Godel takes a formula and translates this formula to a formula which has this particular form. There exists for all, and then a formula which is free from the quantifier. This is exactly a categorification of this idea. So this is a sort of Prenek's normal form. You can change the slide. Do you have any question about this definition? Okay.
I have a question, please.
Yes.
Why to call this theorem Prenek's normal form and not dialectical interpretation or something like that?
Yes. This is just, this is, for example, in classical, in classical logic, we have that every formula admits a Prenek's normal form presentation, which means that every formula is probably equivalent to a formula in which we have all the quantifier on the left and then a formula on the right, which is free from the existential quantifier. So this is just to give an intuition of what this property means in some sense. This is to give an idea, because maybe the dialectic interpretation is, I think that if one sees this definition for the first time, and maybe one could not know anything about the dialectic interpretation, but the Prenek's normal form is more intuitive in this sense. So this is the reason why we choose this name.
Okay. Can I add something? The thing is, Petrusiu, that the Godel fibration will do more than just the Prenek's normal form, right?
Yes, yes,
because,
that's my point.
Because in dialectic interpretation has three different extra things, and that's one of them, the fact that there is a notion of Prenek's normal form.
Yes, sure. Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
And now I would like to explain how this notion is connected to the dialectic interpretation, because the dialectic interpretation is our starting point. So in the following slide, I want to recall the construction for an arbitrary fibration, I'm sorry that I cannot use the mouse to point the arrow and the objects of the in a slide. So I'm very sorry. But in any case, the dialectical construction in the vibrational setting. So if we have a vibration P whose base category is Cartesian closed, we can define a new category denoted, which is the dialectical category associated to the vibration, as follow. The objects of this category were the first component, where the first three components are object of the base category, and the last one is an object. Oh, thank you, Bruno, for pointing the in the last in the last element is a formula. So it is an element of the fiber over over the product of E times X times U, and the intuition is that the first element of the quadruplets, the I, represents those variables which are free in the formula alpha. The second element, X, represents those variables which are bounded by the existential quantifier. And the third one represents those variables which are bounded by a universal quantifier in alpha. So this is an object of the dialectical category associated to a given vibration. A morphism between two objects is again a quadruplet, where the first is the first component is an arrow of the base, is an amorphism in the base category. So again, it is a term in some sense. The second element is again an arrow amorphism in the base category from I times x to y. And the last one and the third component is again a morphism of B, and we require in the and we require that the last component of this notion of morphism is essentially a proof. So it is an arrow in the in a given a vertical arrow in a given fiber between these two formulas. So we have that in this case, an arrow amorphism in a dialectical category is given by three terms and a proof from this alpha where we have applied the substitution into the other formula beta where we have applied the substitution with the first and the second terms. This is a technique, this is very, I understand this is a definition which is a bit technical, but this is the, I think, the most general version of the dialectical construction for in the vibrational setting. In the next slide, I want to show how these two notions are connected, the notion of the Gödel vibration in the dialectical. In the dialectical, every dialectical vibration validates the principle of scholemization. So if we consider a vibration whose base category is Cartesian closed, then the dialectical vibration satisfies the same principle of the Gödel vibration. And this is a result due to Hofstra. In the next slide, I want to show that these two notions coincide. So if we have this is our main result. If we have a vibration with simple products and simple coproduct, such that the base category is Cartesian closed, then this vibration is an instance of the dialectical construction, if and only if it is a Gödel vibration. So there exists a vibration P prime such that the dialectical construction applied to P prime is isomorphic to P, if and only if P is a Gödel vibration. So the notion of Gödel vibration is really an intrinsic version of the dialectical construction, because I use the word intrinsic because the notion of the Gödel vibration underlines the logical principle which the vibration P has to satisfy. So we don't need to check if there exists other vibration such that when we apply the dialectical construction to this other vibration, we get P. If we have a vibration, we just need to check if this vibration is a Gödel vibration or not, without using any other vibration P prime. Moreover, if we have a Gödel vibration, and this is I want to show a sketch of the proof. Well, Hofstra, the idea behind the proof, Hofstra show the original dialectical construction can be seen as the composition of two free constructions, which are two pseudomonad. The first one, sum, is the free construction, is the a construction which freely adds simple coproducts to a given vibration. And the second one is the free construction that freely adds the simple product to a given vibration. And there is an isomorphism of vibration, which is this in the lemma, between the dialectical pseudomonad and the vibration obtaining by applied first the simple products completion and then the simple coproduct completion. And these two completions are fully dual. In particular, we have that the simple products completion can be obtained by changing two times the order in the simple coproducts completion. The idea is that the universal quantifier can be written as using the negation and the existential quantifier. This is the idea behind this isomorphism, and this is the reason why there is this duality. But this is very useful because concretely we just need to study one of these two constructions, and then by duality we can obtain the result for the other one. We can go to the last slide. Okay. And well, this is the sketch of the proof. What we proved is that given a vibration P with simple coproducts, we have that this vibration is an instance of the simple coproduct completion if and only if it has enough objects which are free from the existential quantifier. And in this case, we have that the vibration P is isomorphic to the simple coproduct completion of the vibration P prime, which is the sub-vibration whose object are the element free from the existential quantifier of P. And the dual result is that a vibration with the simple product is an instance of the simple product completion if and only if it has enough objects which are free from the universal quantifier. And again, in this case, we have that if a vibration is an instance of the simple product completion, then it is the simple product completion of the sub-vibration whose elements are those elements of the vibration P which are free from the universal quantifier. So this is a sketch of proof that that we did. You can find all the detail on in our work on archived called the Gödel vibration. And now I would like to conclude. I would like just to mention some application and the future works and the future application of this result. In particular, this presentation of the Gödel vibration, I think that can be used to concretely produce example of category which are dialectical category. Because as you have seen, the definition of a dialectical category is quite complicated. So it is not easy to show genuine examples of dialectical categories. But maybe using this presentation, we can use our notion to provide concrete example. And in particular, there is one example that I want to mention in the proof in relevant case. So not if we consider just positive vibration or doctrine. It's more essentially a doctrine, which is essentially a functor from a base category to the category of posits. If we consider a doctrine, which is a particular case, a very particular case of vibration, if we consider a doctrine, which is a doctrine associated to a posit, when we apply the universal and existential completion, we get a dialectica doctrine. And this is exactly the doctrine, and a doctrine of this kind, it is exactly the doctrine associated to a posit, which is the which is essentially the inf semilattice completion followed by the sub semilattice completion of our starting posit. So this means that every doctrine which is associated to in general associated to a locale, which is obtained as the simple, which obtained as the inf semilattice completion and then a sub semilattice completion of a given posit, this doctrine is an example, is a genuine example of the dialectica construction. So I think that now we can I have finished with this talk. And if you have any slide, if you have any question, I'm here.
Thank you very much, David. So
I'm very sorry for the technical problem.
No problem.
Thank you, Bruno, for the slide for me. I'm sorry.
So as you now have some time for questions, comments.
Right. No. Thanks, David. Very good. Excellent. With all the difficulties of moving the slides and stuff.
There are some point that yes, has been a little strange without the control of the slides, the presentation. It is the first time.
It makes it hard. Like, particularly in the case of this kind of somewhat complicated concepts, right? But I want to kind of press you on some stuff on that, because there are kind of the specific case, isn't that what people, I mean, haven't people considered it already? Haven't the guys talked about dialectica hyperdoctrines and stuff? I think didn't Bourdieu and other people talked about it. You should check it out. I think there was some...
I think that Behring, Stryker, Van Oosten, and Island himself introduced the notion of dialectica tripos. But again, there are no example, no genuine example of doctrines obtained in this way. But I think that a very simple example is this one. Every localic doctrine, I mean that every localic doctrine on a given locale, which is the free completion of a posit, it is a dialectica doctrine, which means that this is obtained by applying the universal completion and the existential completion on the posit, on the starting posit.
No, that's good, because it's not a single example, but a whole family of those, right? So that's
good. More generally, every representable pre-sheaf associated to an object which is a posit in a given topos, if we get this pre-sheaf and we apply this to construction, we get exactly a representable pre-sheaf on an object which is a locale in the topos.
That's very good. I have a few more other questions, but I'll shut up a little bit and see if other people want to ask questions.
If anyone has any questions, you may just ask or click on the raise hand button. Valeria, it's up to you.
I didn't understand the question.
Yes, please.
But I need to see the slides, Bruno. May you
just a moment
slides again? Thank you.
Which one?
Go back.
Back. I'm sorry.
Back. And one more back, I think. Yes. I misunderstood. Why do you need these three sets here in the definition of the objects? Because as far as I remember, you use two objects, to define the dialectical category. You have x, y, and alpha.
And yes, because
I, x, y, and alpha.
Yes, sure. Because I think that the original purpose of Valeria was to consider a triple, because the element is essential. The last one element, if you go to the first, to the second slide or third slide of this talk, the second element, the last one element, which is the sub-object in the definition of the dialectical category, is an element which is free from both the existential and universal quantifier. So this is the reason why in that particular case we use just two objects of the base category. In this case, this is a general construction in which we consider also proposition which has some free variables, while in the original one the element of a given file of the object of the dialectical category are a formula of the form there exists x such that for all y, and then a formula which is free from the existential, which is with no free variables, while in this case which is a general definition, we are considering also those propositions of the form that exists x such that for all y, and then a formula we may have other free variables.
Okay, thank you.
Valeria? That was a very good question, Petrucio, because it is exactly the difference between what people called the propositional dialectica versus the first order dialectica, which is what David is presenting, is the first order.
Nice.
And, you know, my questions are kind of about the fact about your other question, Petrucio, the one about escolemization, because escolemization is just one of the characteristics of the dialectica. There is Markov's principle and there is independence of premise, which is the other two things that we would like to characterize categorically. So I think, you know, if you don't get anything else apart, anything more from David's talk, I think what you can get is this idea that some things are easy in logic, like saying this formula has no existentials. But then when we have this beautiful translation between the logic and the category theory, but some things are easier in the category theory side and some things are easier in the logic. In particular, saying this business of this formula has no existentials is very easy to say in logic, but requires all this framework that David constructed, right, with the fibrations, with the existential free objects, and constructing the co-products, constructing the sub-fibration. So, you know, doing that categorically is hard, and it's easy in the logic. But some other things are the opposite. They are kind of easier in the category theory and harder in the logic. And you know, I think that is part of our work together, is exactly to try to extract as much information as we can from the correspondence. So I think the two things that we're still kind of trying to sort out are exactly, you know, what can we say about independence of premise now that we have this way of talking about.
For example, now with all this instrument, it is very easy to see that if a Gödel vibration has also, if we consider a Gödel vibration which has the implication in the fiber, it is immediate to prove that this Gödel vibration validates the principle of independence of premises. It is a very direct proof because we have this universal property which is very useful. So there are a lot of results that can be, that are very easy to prove after this object, as Valeria said, which are free from the existential quantifier. But now there are another example is that if we consider, for example, in realizability, if we consider the realizability tripos, which is a particular case of the existential completion, well, it is very easy to show that it validates the principle of the premises, the principle of scolemization, the principle of choice, because if we prove that this is an existential completion, all these choice principle and all these properties come from free. So this is the hard part is to show that this is an existential completion. But if we are able to prove this, there are a lot of results which are follow directly.
And another question then: what about the Markov principle? Do we have any handle on that too?
I don't know, because I admit that I'm not an expert of this particular principle, so I don't know, but I don't know the answer, because for example, a Gödel vibration is just a generic vibration. We are not requiring anything in the fibers. Right. If we require the implication, then we get immediately the principle of the independence of premises. But I don't know if we require, for example, the negation and all the other, if we get the mark, because I think that we need also the natural number object to express the Markov principle or not?
I don't think so. No. But that's interesting. Let's think about it. That sounds good to think about it. And I promise my last question, because everyone wants to go home.
Don't worry.
But the last question is about the application to the team semantics sort of story, the independence friendly logic of Joko van Ammen and Abramsky. You think that they have a connection. I don't know why, so I would like you to be reminded of what is the connection.
I must admit, I don't know what is the exact connection, but I remember that I think that Hofstra in his paper says that this is there could be an interesting application in that direction, but I don't know but I remember that I think it is in the work of Hofstra that there is written that there should be interesting application in that direction, but I don't know, because I don't study exactly all the instrument introduced in the work of Abramsky, but I remember that Hofstra said that this be an interesting future work.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Any other question or comment? So thank you very much again, David.
Last question here.
Ah, okay.
Last question here. Sorry. Dialectical interpretation means to interpret heightened arithmetics in primitive recursive arithmetics, let's say. Okay?
Yes.
Now you have a notion of dialectical category. Gödel category. I don't remember the name exactly now, because that I needed the slides, but okay, I think I understand. So can we say that you are extending the interpretation to other logics, to more general logics?
Yes, sure, because I want to make an example. For example, in logic, we have the double negation translation, right? Mm-hmm. And this is a translation. This is a technique that we can apply in different settings. The dialectica translation is similar, but it is a translation. It is a technique. So we can apply this kind of translation for other cases. For example, we have that dialectica, an interesting application. We have that the dialectica interpretation. Well, Gödel introduced the dialectic interpretation for the intuitionistic arithmetic. But at this point, we can combine, for example, the dialectica interpretation with the double negation. So we can apply result. The double negation is a translate, allows to pass from intuitionistic logic to classical logic. So we can combine this construction, for example. This is just the dialectic translation is a way to translate. It is a translation, so it can be applied in different settings, for example.
Yeah, but my question is if your work can be used to generalize this notion to other logics, proving that
to other logics, yes.
Proving that they satisfy some conditions that they should satisfy to generate a kind of category or something like that. Is this a silly question or not?
Can you try to explain that? I don't understand it because...
I'm asking if you are trying kind of capturing a kind of axiomatic of logics that fit this framework, using this notion of category that you are working, that you are building.
Well, I think, Petrusio, that it's already able to apply that to several different other logics, because, you know, the vibration P that it is being built upon, kind of, it's a way of dealing with other logics too. So, you know, yes, you're right. It is a way of applying the interpretation to other logics, and you can play the speed as much as you want.
For example, yes, for example, if you get any law, if you consider any first order theory, you can construct the syntactic vibration from this first order theory, right? Yep. And now we can apply the universal and existential completion, and what we get is a dialectica. Fibre is a dialectical category because by definition and by the universal property of the existential and the universal completion, we get that there exists an arrow from our starting vibration, which is the syntactic vibration, into this dialectical vibration. And this arrow is exactly the translation that takes a formula and maps this formula into another. So this works in for every first order theory, because these two construction it works if we have if we admit also the exponents in the type system, because we need the exponents in the type system to apply correctly this construction, because we can always apply a universal completion then the existential completion. But if we want to obtain the dialectica construction, we need to have the exponent type in the type system. But yes, if you consider any first order logic on a type system with the exponents, you can apply this to construction to the syntactic vibration. And the canonical arrow from this syntactic vibration in the dialectical construction is exactly the translation.
That was my question. Thank you very much.
Yes, I'm sorry. Okay, now I understand the point.
Any other question? So thank you very much, David. It was really nice.
Thank you a lot, Bruno. I'm sorry again for this.
No problem.
This disaster of the slides.
No problem. It is not the first time to have people have to ask for it, but because for other reasons.
Okay. Super. Thanks so much, David. See you soon.
Thank you.
See you soon.